But the J-36 wasn't the only aircraft that made headlines, because 2,500 kilometers away, Beijing had another war machine up its sleeve. While the J-36 was conducting initial flight tests in the central Chinese city of Chengdu, another possible sixth-generation aircraft took flight in northeast China, in the city of Shenyang, home of China's second major aircraft maker, the Shenyang Aircraft Corporation.
You notice we have been all this time been talking about the new fighter jet that came out of Chengdu Aviation Group. We're talking about the J-36. There's a whole different new aircraft that came from Shenyang that we have not talked about. Would you like to talk about it?
Sure. I mean, I think generally speaking, I've been spending a lot more time on the Chengdu one because it's just a lot more capable design, right? But the Shenyang project was actually a bigger surprise to people. Not that they had a program. Like, I was pretty sure they had a program just due to some of the, you know, personal sources I had. But we did not expect it to be flown at the same time. I was expecting the Shenyang project to lag a little bit, to maybe fly in 2025 instead of 2024. So that was a huge surprise for us. I was able to fly basically in the same week, and actually people would say the Shenyang project flew first. So, you know, the reason why you need a Shenyang project is twofold. One is the Navy needs one basically, and the J-36 is huge, and it's going to be produced in much smaller numbers. And I don't know the Shenyang project the Air Force needs, but you know, there's probably areas like western part of the country that you don't really need J-36 for, that they can take care of like any kind of threats like India and stuff like that, but the Navy really needs, you know, next generation aircraft. If you think about like the naval side of things, right? Look, the American program FAXX basically had their budget cut by 70% for their, you know, R&D for the next 5 years. So, you know, if that doesn't change, basically the FAXX falling far behind any other schedules, right? So what you have with the American Navy is basically their Air Force is comprised mostly of Super Hornets and some F-35Cs. And that is going to be a huge miss. Once the Shenyang sixth generation joins service, this will be a huge mismatch in the naval warfare, because you have one side with a sixth generation aircraft that's like a lot harder to see, that has much better radar and electronic warfare equipment that can control a lot more drones, and then you have just a bunch of F-35s. That after they spend a couple months in the sea, their stealth level goes down a little bit because, you know, just rust and stuff like that. And it's not really, you get to a situation where if we have open battle in the sea, the only major advantage that the U.S. fleet have will be the underwater component of things. Whereas, you know, in the aero component of things, it's very clear that, you know, China will be able to have an air superiority there, and that applies a lot of pressure to the carrier group. So, you know, as China becomes more of a country that goes further and further out, the PLA has like longer range missions, then whether it's your carrier groups or your Type 076, amphibious ships, You're gonna need like a central controlling sixth generation aircraft that can control the airspace, and that extends your control further out in the sea. And that's kind of like the point of having the Shenyang project.
Do you have time to quickly talk about the Type 76 amphibious assault ship that China just launched? I mean, it's reputedly the world's largest, or one of the world's largest amphibious assault ships. And it has an electronic catapult, and it's capable of launching planes from its deck, even though it's supposedly a helicopter dock, right? But it has the capability of probably launching J-35s in the future. So why is China moving to the, in that direction, building these large amphibious landing
ships? So I think the first thing you have to think about is that I have to warn people to not think of these ships as light aircraft carriers. Some people like to think of them that way, but you know, the primary role of your Type 076 is still for amphibious assault. So the they have to have well decks so that the landing so that you can send out like your landing craft and they can be used to attack other countries' targets. They're not built for open, they're not designed originally for mainly for the open sea battle against a peer competitor. So for a Taiwan scenario, you can have something like a Type 076 on the eastern side of Taiwan that can attack from that side with its various attack stealthy aircraft and then land along the way. But obviously, for a longer term view, these aircraft, when you have these like ships, when you have enough of them, they're going to be important for sea control purposes. Also, you can theoretically have like a fleet led by Type 076 that has maybe 10 drones and maybe one or two like J-35s or the Shenyang project in the future. Like, not many, just because the thing is, since they were built more for amphibious assaults, they don't have the same jet fuel payload or the just the weapons storage as a real aircraft carrier. So you can't think of them entirely as a super carrier. But against a smaller components, they could still control the air and decimate the air defenses against less capable opponents. Let's say Philippines or even Australia, for example, right? So they do have their purposes, and it's very important to think that as the People's Liberation Army move further out, right, there might be new scenarios usage for Type 076 that we haven't seen yet, that goes well beyond amphibious assault over Taiwan. So this is one way in which they can have like what we call flat deck fleet that goes beyond carriers. You don't really need to send your carriers out for every different kind of mission. Yeah, you certainly don't want to have like a Type 076 led fleet go up against a U.S. carrier group. That would be a really horrible idea.
That's fair. Okay. Any is there anything else you would like to talk about?
Yeah, I think people should just think about this as not the end game, but like just this is just part of the process, right? Like the Chinese cadence is really quick. I think that's one thing that we learn from this. Like a lot of us were expecting sixth generation flight to make their first flight in 2026 range. So this beat our expectations a little bit. Now it beat the Pentagon expectation by much longer than that, because they were just kind of caught completely off guard by this, actually. And a lot of people would want to figure out what the next generation looks like, right? That's a big question out of this. And the thing to focus for the next generation is that I'm not sure we're going to have another generation of piloted aircraft. I think the drone technology might get to the point where the future combat aircraft can be controlled pretty securely through either satellites or something remotely, and has enough autonomous technology built into it. It doesn't do anything stupid that you don't need pilots anymore. And the big improvements you can make to that is having these like high supersonic or hypersonic drones. So what we're seeing recently is a lot of what we call these supersonic and hypersonic engine tests that they're doing. And I'm expecting drones to be able to go to Mach 4, Mach 5. And that's going to be the next generation of things.
Didn't China just recently test supersonic drones like right after the unveiling of J-36?
Yes, and I think that's the first part of it. And I think it's going to, that's why I think it's going to be a faster, something that's going to appear faster than people think. Because you could have a situation where you have your thing that you want to attack, and then J-36 sprints over there first, and then you have your hypersonic drones come a little later, fly a little later in because they can get there faster, and then you can direct the hypersonic drones to their hypersonic tactics. Anything that flies, that comes, that gets released high in the air by hypersonic vehicle, it's going to come down really quick, right? Because they were already flown at hypersonic speed, and then you drop them, and then they can glide and hit the target really quick, and it'd be very hard to defend. So that will be a first phase of this hypersonic drone. And they're continuously getting more and more with these engines and with these drones over time, until to the point where you are going to have the hypersonic drones as part of the strike package with the sixth generation aircraft. And, you know, people ask me what is going to happen once Americans have, you know, their NGAD into service. I typically would say that the next major thing you're going to see out of China are hypersonic or high supersonic drones that can fly really high. And they're going to be very hard to defend because there's nothing that really goes fast enough to actually shoot them down.
This has been a fascinating conversation. And I'm sure we're going to have you back in the future to talk more on this topic. Is there anything else you'd like to cover?
Yeah, I would say this is obviously a very exciting moment for people concerned about the military situation around Chinese waters. And this also debunks a lot of the Pentagon theories about why there must be like a Taiwan invasion in 2027, because, you know, why would you need to do that when you have a clear advantage coming in 2031 and 2032 range, right? And the hope is that, you know, there's enough, these Chinese project comes in, that it just simply deters, makes people think that it's just not worth it to, you know, engaging any kind of military affair.
You found small group up in the Pentagon that U.S. have a small, limited time window to stop China's rise. I think this is why there's so much focus on 2027, because I think beyond that, you know, China would be almost unstoppable, beyond 2030 range. I think there's a lot of anxiety in Pentagon and in the top echelon of U.S. political establishment because of that. So let's hope people not going to do anything stupid in the next few years. but yeah, I agree with you in general. China, time is on China's side. China is getting stronger year by year. That trend is continuing despite all the copium production in the West.
I think one other thing to think about is like of all the different industries out there, right? I would say aerospace is one industry where they have been behind Western countries. Pretty obvious gap between them and Western countries. If you're able to develop such an advanced aircraft, then it showcases that your domestic industry is really building up. And, would not be surprising if like in 10, 15 years time, China also has like a really internationally competitive domestic aviation industry. And we're kind of already seeing that right now with all the different projects that they have in the pipeline, and with all the drone industries that they have, the low altitude economy. And
plus the self-destruction of Boeing is a big bonus. that's just another.
It's kind of funny. The past year has been terrible for America's, hard tech companies. But don't worry, the stock market is growing.
Well, there's a time limit on that. I mean, nothing goes up forever. This is great. This is great. I'm sure I will have you back shortly to discuss more in China's tech development, because this is a fast moving field. We're coming, there's surprises coming one after another. You know, J-35 just flew and now they're flying the sixth generation aircraft. It's a very pleasant surprise. Thank you for giving us a heads up back in November, I think. You have to let us know if there's more surprises.
Maybe not within the next year, because this was pretty unexpected. I don't think anyone expected this much stuff. You know, even I wasn't expecting there to be two programs at the same time. So the next one and people are looking out for is the H-20 program, but it's not going to be this level of a surprise.
Yeah, and people are kind of expecting H-20 to drop anytime for a while now. So, well, thank you very much, TP. This has been a very fruitful and fascinating conversation, and I look forward to have a future conversation with you on this topic. And thanks, everyone, for listening. And for people who want to follow you, TP.
Yeah, so... I have a Substack right now. I'm writing up a lot on the 6th gen section of things for under TP Huang. And I also have my Twitter account, TP Huang, which I write wide variety of topics. But recently I seem to be spending more time on the 6th gen because this was such an interesting event.
There you have it, folks. Go follow TP on Twitter. Go subscribe to his Substack. You know, he has all the latest insight on the Chinese tech development, which is a very fast moving field. Thank you again for making this, making time for us, TP, and thanks everyone for listening. Until next time. Bye-bye.